Stay yoast, people.
I thought I would do a longer gouache video this time, and before I get into that, I thought I would talk a little bit about the materials I use. This is a B paper, super deluxe sketchbook. The paper is heavyweight, and it can handle decent washes with watercolor and gouache really well. This next one is a pentalic sketchbook. It's similar to the moleskin sketchbook, but I find the paper a lot better when it comes to working with watercolor. It's 140 pound and full cotton. This is a moleskin sketchbook. They're okay for gouache too. As long as you have thick paper, gouache works pretty well on it. Most of the stuff I do is from these chopped pieces from every time I get an illustration job or something that I'm using watercolor paper. If I'm cutting off pieces, I'll always make these tiny little blocks that I can carry around. And they vary from all different kinds of sizes. I had trouble with the 500 pound watercolor paper because it absorbed too much, but the lighter weight but heavy watercolor paper works really well. These are the palettes that I use. This is a baker's tray. They're really cheap and you can get them at craft stores. This is an old Schmincke box. They're great. They're really handy little boxes and they can really take a beating over time. I cut the thin side off of this one and it's kind of rusting out, but I use it in my travel bag. This box was one I made myself. It's an adaptation on the box that Peter Chan uses in his tutorials on Gumroad. I really liked that box for holding and storing gouache, especially for traveling, so I got some aluminum sheets from the Home Depot nearby, and I made a little rig and I built this little box. You can store 24 colors in it. You can buy them on eBay or different places online. The only downfall is you can't tilt the box or drop it or it'll all pour out, and you have to make sure it all dries before you close the lid. Or otherwise it'll get all moldy on the inside. But it helps for traveling, especially for cons and things that I need a lot of paint for, small sketches and stuff. Alright, let's get started. If I'm not using my yellow travel box, if I'm using the butcher tray, or I'm just using gouache directly from the tube, I always wet a paper towel and then put the paint directly on it. It's good to make two dots of white so that you have a clean, fresh white for when you need it later on. I start out this sketch like I do most of my sketches with gouache by putting down some yellow ochre and just kind of trying to cover the page as much as I can with a very thin layer of gouache. I start with a lot of water for the first couple layers just to get some color down and to get a kind of tacky quality to the paper that I'm working on. I picked an avocado and a lemon for this sketch because I wanted to do something that focused on surfaces and different surface qualities. The avocado has a very specific sort of texture to it and a thickness to it. And it also, it's kind of shiny, and the seed on the inside is very glossy and sort of slimy, so I wanted to work with that. And also a translucent lemon so that the interior, just to sort of deal with what happens as the light creates a shadow but also bounces into the skin of the lemon and then creates a sort of glow, a soft glow like a candle. Now that I have a kind of value guide down with the yellow ochre, I'm coming back with less water on the brush and making a thicker layer of a sort of varied brownish color of the cutting board, and then I'm starting to fill in some of the local color just to put in a medium thickness or a medium wetness to the brush layer that I can then add an even thicker layer on top of. Right now I'm dealing with the local color, but also dealing with the fact that the light is coming from behind the objects. So the green on the right half of the avocado is going to be very light, but the green facing away from the light is dulled down slightly. And of course darker because it's in the shadow. I'm starting to carve out the pit or the hole where the seed was on the other side of the avocado just placing some color to try to find the right value of what I'm looking at. It's going to be lighter, and the shadow is going to be interesting because the light is going to go into, it's a green on green shadow, so the light's going to bounce all around and create a sort of glow inside the little cave where the seed was. Because light's going to bounce off the one green, and then it's going to shoot that green up into the actual shadow. So it's going to be a very saturated shadow. I kept the full recording for this sketch together because I make a lot of mistakes in this, and I wanted to save that for people who see this, because a lot of times it's just sort of fumbling around and comparing, because every time you put down a color, it's going to change some of the other colors, it's going to change their value and their relationships. One of the big things I did was I put that cutting board color down, but then as I put in the everything else, I noticed that I made that cutting board way too dark. So later on in the sketch, I'm going to have to lighten that up a whole lot. I'm putting in the outside of the avocado. I'm going to try to sneak in some reds, a little bit of alizarin crimson. I do the same on the seed of the avocado. I'm basically trying to sneak two complementary colors so you get the red right next to the green. Now I'm trying to focus in on the shadow on the higher side of the lemon. Because it's translucent, the light's going to be coming in through the shadow and then bouncing all around. So I want to try to keep the shadow very saturated and very warm. I'm trying to clean up the drawing on the lemon and get the shape correct, and then start in on the rind of the lemon. I don't want to use too much white in it because it's light, but it's also in shadow, and it's only catching a little bit of a secondary light. I also want to save the purer whites for the places I really want to pop with the highlight. Even though the film is sped up quite a bit, I hope you notice how little water I'm actually using. I use a lot of the water that's already on the palette from previous color mixing. And even when I do dip in for water, I usually let it run off or I dab it on a paper towel just to get off a lot of the extra water. It takes some practice, but if you use too much water, it'll pull up the lower layers on the painting and make a whole mess. It'll either overblend the picture or you'll clean it back down to white on accident, which is kind of nice with gouache because even though that's a problem you could have, it also, you know, you could erase if you make a mistake. So I try not to use too much water. The nice thing about gouache is with a little bit of water, you can kind of pull the layer beneath it or next to it. So kind of like with oil, how you can blend colors, gouache has a really good ability to blend together once it's down, as long as you're careful with the water. Here I'm darkening the shadows because, again, as I'm putting things in, I'm noticing that it's changing the value. So I have to darken the shadows a little bit, and I'm starting to try to give some form to that seed. I notice a slight red, and I take the opportunity right here to get some alizarin crimson in the mix so that I can place some reds right next to the green. You can already kind of see a difference here when the red is right next to that green. People have all different kinds of methods of applying the paint, but I'm trying to paint the brush along the form to try to draw it in three-dimensional space. Even though watercolor is my primary medium and my focus, I still mess around and experiment with gouache and with oil. I recommend you do the same because when you try in a different medium, it forces you to rethink how you apply the color and how you see the objects that you're looking at. When I started experimenting with gouache, it was an absolute failure. So I started experimenting with oil, and I learned a lot about how to apply gouache, which then made me think differently about how I apply watercolor. And it improved my ability as a painter overall, just experimenting. This is when I noticed that the cutting board is way too dark. So I come in with some white, and it's a warm light, so I warm it up with some yellow ochre, and I start to apply it, trying to move along with the surface of the wood grain that it's sitting on. At this point, this is one of those things that if you're starting with gouache, you just have to stick through it with sketches a lot of times, and watercolor is the same way. You just kind of have to keep going because you can adjust and you can work with things, and with gouache you can always fix things. So you just have to just hang in there with the picture because you can pull the nose up. And if you don't, it's no big deal. You just start over, start on something else. You'll always learn something by experimenting with it. At this point, I'm noticing that I have a lot of hard edges. Those shadows, after I kind of got them corrected, they created this chunky, blocky feel. So I'm coming back in with just a little bit of moisture and a little bit of color, and I'm trying to just sort of fudge them and blend them in a little bit to sort of lose the edges a little bit. I want the sharper edges to be on the object of interest, and everything else to have a lot looser edges, softer edges, so that they fall away into the distance a little more. Here I'm about to fix another mistake I made in the drawing on the right avocado piece, because it wasn't quite right, so I had to come in with that green and open it up a little more. I mentioned that to just encourage you to work through your mistakes. At this point in the picture, it's just putting in the darkest darks and then finding the lightest lights with a more pure white. I'm happy with the relationships of the value and the color. So at this point, I'm just noodling away at the detail. Here I'm trying to adjust the shadow, but I also want to get the feeling of that yellow bouncing around. Light bounces around everywhere all the time, so it's anytime you can pick up these little notes, like that yellow that's bouncing off that lemon, you can create a really nice realistic feel that's also subtle. All that's left from here was to put in where the cutting board cut off. That's it for this demonstration. I hope you found it encouraging and informative and helpful in some way. If you have any questions, let me know in the comment section. I can try to tackle it in a future video. And I'd love to hear about your solutions for palettes with gouache or traveling with gouache. In the meantime, happy sketching!